scripture reading today comes from Matthew, chapter 27, verses 39 through 49. And those passing by were hurling abuse at him, wagging their heads, and saying, "You who are going to destroy the temple and rebuild it in 3 days, save yourself. If you are the Son of God, come down from the cross." In the same way, the chief priest also, along with the scribes and elders, were mocking him and saying, "He saved others. He cannot save himself. He is the King of Israel. Let him now come down from the cross, and we will believe in him. He trusts in God. Let God rescue him now. If he delights in him, for he said, 'I am the Son of God.'" The robbers who had been crucified with him were also insulting him with the same words. Now from the sixth hour, darkness fell upon all the land until the ninth hour. About the ninth hour, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, saying,
"Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani?"
That is, my God, why have you forsaken me?" And some of those who were standing there, when they heard it, began saying, "This man is calling for Elijah." Immediately, one of them ran and, taking a sponge, he filled it with sour wine and put it on a reed and gave him a drink. But the rest of them said, "Let us see whether Elijah will come to save him."
Can you imagine the loneliness Jesus felt at that hour? After 3 hours of darkness. You ever wonder about those hours of darkness? You ever wondered what that was all about? I've always just assumed that it was a solar eclipse, that the moon came between us and the sun. How many of you have ever heard of a 3-hour eclipse? They last, 10 minutes at the most? Generally about 6 or 7 minutes from start to finish. Besides, what time of year was this? It was time of the full moon. That's when Passover happens. Tonight, last night or tonight, is the new moon, the dark of the moon, when you can see the first sliver of the moon once it passes through that. This month of the Jewish year has begun. Passover begins 14 days after that. That's Passover. Solar eclipses don't happen during a full moon. Full moon is where we see the sun reflecting off the moon. The only time it can happen is during a new moon, during the dark of the moon. The moon can come between us and the sun. My theory, nobody knows. Nobody's got an answer. My theory is there was some space junk. You know, there's collisions and things going on in space all the time. You watch dirt and stuff on a pond and how it will gather together in one place. And to me, this was pointed out to me, I didn't think of it. But maybe some space junk, a cloud of junk passed through, and God knew it was going to happen that day. That's where the darkness comes from. What we're doing is going through Jesus' the seven last words on the cross. They're actually phrases, they're comments. Now, the first thing he said, just as they had set him up, he said, "Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing." A little bit later, as everybody was making fun of him and saying the things you heard in that scripture, "Come on down, save yourself, you saved others." One of the the robbers on the cross next to him was doing the, giving him a hard time. And the other one said, man, don't you know who this is? And we deserve to be up here. We have done things that we deserve to die, but not this man. This man has never done anything like that. Then he turned to Jesus and said, when you come into your kingdom, will you remember me? Jesus' word is, today you will be with me in paradise. The first thing was the promise of forgiveness. The second thing was the promise of salvation. No matter how we've done, once we look to Jesus, the forgiveness was given without asking for it. The salvation had to be asked for. Then the last time we looked at him, he looked down at his mother, and he looked at John, and he said, woman, this is your son. She was probably a widow and needed to be taken care of, and he was taking care of that. This, we're told, is an example of love, a fulfillment of the love that we expect from God. Now what about his saying, Eli, Eli, Lama, Sabachthani? That's Aramaic, meaning, my God, why have you forsaken me? Now, was he quoting the first verse of the 22nd Psalm? That's what David wrote in the 22nd Psalm. My God, why have you forsaken me? We can understand David doing it. David has been anointed to be king, but Saul has been king. And Saul has given him a fit, chased him all over the place, trying to kill him. But why would Jesus do it? Was he hanging on the cross in pain and singing psalms to himself? A couple of weeks ago, they had a story in the paper. Remember baby Jessica? See that story? It happened about the same time as Princess Diana's death in Paris. So. But in this country, it was baby Jessica that got all the attention. 2.5 days, she was down a well. And in the story, they said she lost part of her toe because her foot was wedged between her head and the wall of the thing. But during that, during the time she was in there, she was singing one of the big bird, what was that TV show? Susie had to remind me this morning. Sesame Street. She was singing a song from Sesame Street. Down in the well. Is that what Jesus was doing? I doubt it, but could be. Could be. What was going on is, why was he feeling that dejection? That's what we're looking at. It's because Jesus was loaded down with sin at that moment. He had taken all the sin of the world that had been done before, had taken all the sin that has happened between now and then, 2,000 years of sin, and all that's going to come after us. All of that sin was on him. All of the sin that was going to be, God had said, you're the only one with that is pure enough to settle my debt. And it was on Jesus. Had God deserted him? No. But at that moment, God couldn't be in his presence because he represented sin. Our sin, my sin, yours. We know that's what happened. Whether he was just paying the debt, or whether he was the substitute for our punishment, that's something for academia and theologists and the teachers to talk about. People that like to talk. But I found the best understanding for me that I think I've ever heard of this don't know the financial business. I know just enough to understand it. Have any of you ever taken a mortgage out of the bank, local bank, and then have them sell the paper to somebody else? I was telling this morning when I went to Shul's, when I went to work for them, the only paper they sold was service contracts. And then while I was there, they quit doing that. But you take a loan out with one outfit, and they need some cash, they will sell your obligation to them to generate some cash to somebody else. So all of a sudden, your debt was with them, now it's with somebody else. Jesus became the sacrificial lamb, which allowed him to be acceptable to God as the blood sacrifice for all our sins. He bought our debt to God, and he now holds the title to our eternal salvation. Now think about that. It was the act of Jesus dying on the cross. He bought our debt, and he holds title to it. So we owe our salvation to Jesus. This course I'm taking, LU Online right now, it's philosophy, and we're dealing with all of the things that Christianity is facing in the world. And one of the things that they accuse us of is being exclusive, along with all the hate stuff and anything else they can dream up. But we're saying that only through Christ can a person gain salvation. That's what the book says. That's what Jesus says. Only through Christ, because Christ has paid the price. He owns the title to our salvation. We have to acknowledge him, just like the thief on the cross, that he controls the game. He controls eternity. Jesus is our atonement, our at-one-ment with God through Christ. God said it. Jesus said it. Paul said, all of the disciples said, it is through Christ that we gain eternity with God. He controls that door. We walk with him. We believe on him. We acknowledge Jesus as our Savior because he paid the price that we'll never pay. And all we've got to do is say yes. And he did it. And just like with the robber, he'll say, today you'll be with me in your heaven. So simple. Salvation is so simple. But it's so hard because we make it hard. We know we have to walk with him. He gives us strength. And we won't do it on our own. But the little old lady in the commercial, I'd rather do it myself. That's the way we are with our salvation sometimes. We want to earn it. Why? It's already all and paid for. And we just have to walk with him. And that's a choice each of us has to make. Not once, but every situation as it comes along. Because to walk with him, we've got to love God like he does. And we've got to love each other like he loves us. And he makes a decision. It's not our question. We walk with him, or we can't get through the gate. Remember that. Talk to him.